Hey everyone, this is Jyotika and welcome to your 17th HTML5 tutorial. In the previous few tutorials, we talked about how to put images on a web page. But images aren't the only kind of media you can put on a site. Through the power of HTML, we can add audio and video files into our websites. In the early days, HTML didn't have the ability to embed video and audio on the web. So plugin-based technologies like Flash and later Silverlight, both of which are now obsolete, became popular for handling such content. This kind of technology worked okay, but it had a number of problems, including not working well with HTML or CSS features, some security issues, and accessibility issues. So, the new HTML5 is designed to kind of avoid the use of having to use plugins or extra software that you don't already have on your machine. It should really be plug and play. If you are going to put a video on your website, people should just be able to see it without having to download Flash or anything along that line. So, let's first take a look at how we can include some music on a web page. We can use the audio element to put audio files on a web page. The HTML is quite simple and is similar to the image element with a few differences. Unlike image, the audio element has both an opening and a closing tag. And just like the image element, we use a src attribute or the source attribute to provide the URL to the file. In this case, an audio file. The audio element also accepts other audio file formats like MP3, WAV, OGG. Then, the audio element is also written with a few more attributes, and we will see what they are in just a bit. So, let's actually go ahead and write the code to see how all this works. I have opened a basic HTML file saved as movies.html. which is linked to the other pages of the website that we were working on in the previous tutorials. So let's create an audio element here with the opening and closing tags. And inside the opening tag, let's link to an MP3 file using the src attribute. I have saved this file in a folder named media. Now let's save this code and see what we have in our browser. Well, actually, we don't see anything here yet. In order to display some sort of audio player here, we need to tell the browser to provide some controls, like a play button, a timeline, a volume control. We can do that by adding the word controls as an attribute in the opening audio tag. Now, this controls attribute appears to be not taking any values like how src equals some URL, or in the case of images, width equals 480. So when you put in just the name of the attribute, it's the same thing as saying controls equals true. So let's save this. And great, now we have an audio player on the page. We can play, pause, change the volume, see the timeline, and even jump around in the timeline. The audio element is a good example of the power of HTML to provide a ready-made functionality that maybe we just don't want to bother to build ourselves. We can use what the browser provides us. There are several other attributes that we can use with the audio. For example, the loop attribute will make the file loop endlessly once the play button is hit. Then there is an autoplay attribute, which will cause the audio to be played automatically as soon as the page loads, at least in some browsers. Now be careful with autoplay. Most people actually hate it when the audio starts playing automatically when they land on a web page. There was a big uproar recently when a social media site started making all of the videos play automatically when you went on their website. And it was eating up a huge amount of bandwidth for people. So maybe you want to avoid using the autoplay unless it's really necessary. Maybe you want a background music for your page, then you can use the autoplay attribute and probably remove the controls attribute so the audio player is not seen on the page. But again, Remember, this could get annoying to your website users if they have no way of stopping the sound playback. Also, the autoplay will work only on some browsers, as not all browsers support the autoplay attribute. So here in Chrome, the autoplay is not working, but in Safari it does. It also depends on the version of your browser. Next, you can also use the muted attribute, which gives you an audio player which is already muted in the beginning when the page loads. And then you can toggle to unmute by clicking on it. The preload attribute specifies if and how the audio file should be loaded when the page loads. It allows you to provide a hint to the browser about what you think will lead to the best user experience. For that, you can put preload equals auto to tell the browser to download the entire audio file as soon as the page loads, regardless of whether the user is expected to play it. So the audio file is ready for the user when he or she decides to play it. It is a good idea to buffer large files in order to provide visitors a smooth listening experience. You can write preload equals none if you think that the browser should not load the sound when the page loads. Or you can have preload equals metadata if you want the browser to only load the metadata of the audio, like the length of the file, when the page loads. Also, if you use the autoplay attribute, then the browser will ignore the preload attribute, because if autoplay is specified, the browser would obviously need to start downloading the audio for playback when the page loads. And remember, the browser is not forced to follow the value of the preload attribute in any of these cases. These are all just hints that we provide. Now, you might be wondering, why do we have both an opening and closing tag for this audio element? Aren't we all set, since we can already play our music? Well, we can stop at this stage, but what if your audio file format is not supported by some browser? Then your site users won't be able to hear the awesome music that you put on your page. To solve this problem, we can use the source elements inside the audio element to specify more than one audio file, just like we did with the picture element in my earlier tutorial. With the source elements, the browser will have fallback options for your audio if there is some issue with a particular format. The browser will use the first file that it understands in the list. This is the current browser support for the different audio formats. So let's remove the SRC attribute from the audio element and instead put it on a source element. This will do the exact same thing as our previous example, but now we can add additional source elements with alternative audio file formats. MP3s are supported in most modern browsers today. There is also Wave and OGG. Here in the type attribute, you write audio/mpeg for the MP3 file, audio/wave for the wave file, and audio/OGG for the OGG file. It's just the type of file. You can skip writing it too, and your audio will still work, but it's a good practice to keep it. Now, sometimes it might happen that your website users are using an older version of a browser, like Internet Explorer 8 or below, that doesn't support the audio element at all. These users might see some sort of blank little broken icon in the place for the audio element that doesn't really convey any information to them. In that case, you can let the users know that there would have been an audio file present here for them to listen if they were using a newer version of the browser. You can provide some fallback text in here informing them of how to access the audio contents. You can write your text just like that in the audio element, or put it inside another element like the P element, or even provide a link to your audio as a fallback. This will only be displayed if the audio element is not understood by the browser at all. And this text and all these other elements, apart from the source element, will be ignored by browsers that do support the audio element. Now let's look at putting some videos on our webpage. One way to put video content on a web page is to use the video element in HTML. The video element is very similar to the audio element. Just like the audio element, we can create a video element with both an opening and a closing tag. Then we use the src attribute to point to a video file. And we add the controls attribute to tell the browser to create a video player for us. Great, and we can see the video with the player on our browser. But the problem is that the video is going way beyond the browser width. It's too huge. So just like we do for the image element, we can put some dimensions for our video using the width and height attributes. And even if your video has a smaller size, you must always mention the width and height for the video element, because if the height and the width are not set, the page might flicker while the video loads when the internet connection is slow. We can also have the loop and autoplay attributes, but again, avoid using them unless it's really necessary. Now, just like before, in between the opening and closing tags, we can use a source element to provide multiple file formats with the src attribute to link to the file, and the type attribute to tell the browser which type of file it is. There are many video formats out there, but HTML currently supports only MP4, WebM, and OGG. And all this works the same way as it does for the audio and picture elements. The browser will play the first file that it understands. This is the current browser support for the different file formats. Then, just like we provided some fallback text for the audio element, we can write some text here in the video element as well to let our users know that there would have been a video here in case the browser does not support the video element at all. You can also include subtitles or captions for your video by using the track element inside the video element. We are not going into the details of it right now, but I am going to add the code for including captions in this file so you will have an idea of how it works. Maybe I will make a separate video on it. Let me know in the comments if you want me to do that. So it's pretty amazing that we can put audio and video on a website using these new HTML5 elements. But there is a slight problem here. The video that I use for my example is a 1080p video. And this is probably a good choice for users who have a bigger screen and a faster network connection. But what about the people who have a slower network connection and a smaller device like a mobile phone or a tablet? We would like to send them a pretty small file. We have a solution for this with images, with the image source set and picture. But there is nothing in HTML that will allow us to send different sizes of video under different network connections. Maybe someone has an HD screen, but the network is kind of slow. So instead of sending them a 1080p file, we want to send them a 720p video. But then, as soon as their network speed improves, we want to switch from 720 to 1080. This is how Netflix, Hulu, YouTube, Vimeo, and all those TV apps work. They are constantly switching from one resolution to another as people watch. The whole thing is really complicated and time-consuming to code, and which is why when you go to put videos on your website, there is a high chance you might not use the video element. Most likely, you will embed a video from another video hosting website. So let's talk about that now. Another easier way to put videos on your website is by embedding them. Embedding is taking content from one site and placing it into the page on another site. There is all kinds of content that you can embed onto a page. You can embed a map from Google. You can embed a code demo from CodePen. It's very common to embed something complex from a service that takes care of all the hard parts for you. So what HTML do we need to know to help us do this? Well, basically, you get the HTML from the service that you're using. Let's use YouTube as an example. Here is a tutorial video from my channel. And let's say I want to post it on our webpage so people can find it on our website itself and not have to go to the YouTube website. I will look for a share button or some other clue about where I can find the embed code. And I see a share here. So let me click on that. And now I see embed written here. So let's click that. Now I see some HTML code. I will click copy and it will copy the code to my clipboard. Now let's paste this into our HTML file. And there you go. I have a video embedded on the page. As easy as that. We don't really need to understand in detail what all of this says. Although now that we know how to read HTML, we can see a lot here that we recognize. The iframe element has many attributes on it, like height and width. We could adjust those if we want. Then there is the SRC attribute which is pointing to the source of the video file. We can also autoplay, loop and mute the video. For doing that here, we need to alter the URL. We have to add ? And then autoplay equals 1. But many browsers added stricter autoplay policies recently. So most of them do not allow autoplay in all cases. However, muted autoplay is always allowed. So just add and mute is equals 1 after autoplay is equals 1 to let your video start playing automatically but muted. And for looping the video forever, just add and loop equals 1. Iframes are powerful, but there are definitely some security issues when you use them. So always double check if the site you are using to embed is safe to use. If it's just you posting your own videos on your own website, then it will be fine. So yeah, it's really awesome that we can add multimedia to our websites with the help of these useful tags in HTML. But just remember, when you're using video or audio, you want to make sure you provide some type of text descriptors, closed captioning, or any links to plugins with the video to make your content accessible to everyone. And finally, the most important thing that I would like you to take away from this tutorial is that multimedia should really enhance your content. You don't want it to be a distraction. You don't want people spending time trying to figure out how to turn it off so they can get to the content of your page. And that's it for today. If you haven't seen my earlier tutorials where I talk about adding images and making them responsive, then I highly encourage you all to watch those. The link to those videos and other interesting content is in the description below. And yeah, let me know in the comments if you have any questions. This is Jyotika signing off. Until next time, keep learning and keep coding.